Our opening hymn is number 128, Led by the Spirit.
Forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Grant, Almighty God, through the yearly observances of Holy Lent, that we may grow in understanding other riches hidden in Christ, and by worthy conduct pursue their effects through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Genesis. God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "See, I am now establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that was with you, all the birds and the various tame and wild animals that were with you and came out of the ark. I will establish my covenant with you, that never again shall all bodily creatures be destroyed by waters of a flood. There shall not be another flood to devastate the earth. God added, "This is the sign that I am giving for all ages to come, of the covenant between you and me and every living creature with you. I set my bow in the clouds to serve as a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow appears in the clouds, I will recall the covenant I have made between me and you and all living beings, so that the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all mortal beings." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Sins once, the righteous for the sake of the unrighteous, that he might lead you to God. Put to death in the flesh, he was brought to life in the spirit. In it, he also went to preach to the spirits in prison, who had once been disobedient while God patiently waited in the days of Noah during the building of the ark, in which a few persons, eight in all, were saved through water. This prefigured baptism, which saves you now, it is not a removal of dirt from the body, but an appeal to God for a clear conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers subject to him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory.
One does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes forth from the mouth of God.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory.
The Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
Say, reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord.
The Spirit drove Jesus out into the desert, and he remained in the desert for 40 days, tempted by Satan. He was among wild beasts, and angels ministered to him. After John had been arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the gospel of God. This is the time of fulfillment. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
What is in my desert? What is in my desert? Now, I'm not asking you to think about if you had to imagine creating a desert, what might be in it, or what you think a desert looks like, whether it be the heat, the sand, the wind, the sun, those sorts of things. But to really think critically, as we are just a several days into Lenten season, to think about what is in my desert. The reason I ask this question, and it's not far-fetched to ask or to think about, is because traditionally on the first Sunday of the Lenten season, we encounter Jesus going into the desert. Now, the gospel according to St. Mark, of course, is very short and brief about this account. In fact, it's only a verse or two, if that. And yet, it is very powerful for us to think about. Even though we don't get the traditional story or the story that we're used to, we think about like in the other accounts where we hear about the Lord being tempted about going up in a high mountain or throwing himself down or the kingdoms of the world or turning stones to the bread, etc. We still have a powerful witness to what Jesus encountered, and also for our own benefit to understand this in a deeper way. For as Jesus went out into the desert, we recognize, and he was among wild beasts, that as Jesus goes into the wilderness, he does so for 40 days. It's a time period that, when we hear the word, the number 40, certainly reminds us of the Israelites wandering in the desert or the floods that consumed the earth in the time of Noah. But when we hear the word 40, it should also remind us of a time of testing and a time of purification. A time of testing, the time of purification. And when we see the wilderness, we see that this is synonymous with sin and temptation. Jesus going out into the wilderness, Jesus going out and being amongst the wild beasts, the sins and temptations, it's what they represent. And Jesus being the new Adam, who will redeem humanity and restore us to right relationship with God the Father, must encounter where our original parents left off. For if we recall that Adam and Eve, as they sinned, were expelled from the Garden of Eden and were not in paradise, where were they? But amongst the wilderness. And interestingly enough, when there was harmony amongst all creation, it's noted that Jesus is among wild beasts. In other words, it seems as though they're a threat. Kind of like wild beasts outside here. You see a coyote, I don't know if there's any bears out here or whatever, but if there were, that'd be a problem. And so Jesus goes out into the wilderness to confront sin and temptation face to face. It's not so much that Jesus is in need of purification, for he is sinless. Because some might wonder, well, why go out in the desert if it's about purification. The Lord is not in need of that, just as we say with baptism. He's not in need of being his sins being washed away. But he does these things to take on and to confront our human condition, the sin that we deal with in this world. And so to that end, we are then called to join with the Lord in our Lenten journey to enter into a desert experience. During the Lenten season, we are in the desert. And so as we are in the desert, though, we are also invited by the church to enter into three things to help us to confront sin and temptation in our world. We know those things are prayer, fasting, and almsgiving. Prayer, fasting, and almsgiving. And certainly we have heard over the years that these are the things that are central to Lenten practices, and they are good things for us to do. And not just during Lent, but at all times throughout the year. They can be helpful and beneficial to our spiritual lives, to our relationships to others, and our relationship with God itself. But why prayer, why fasting, and why almsgiving? They are the way and the path for us to correct, to confront in the desert those things that have gone awry in our life. And so, for example, as the church teaches us in the catechism, that it is prayer that helps us to improve or to work on our relationship with God, that personal relationship we are all called to. It is in fasting that that helps us to uncover any inordinate desires that are going about in our life, things where we find that we're going astray, that we desire more than the love of God or more than God's ways. It helps to correct ourselves, to help us to unearth those things that are in our personal deserts, the things that we hunger for. And then almsgiving, helping us to increase our love of neighbor. In other words, encouraging us to reach out to one another in need. In these ways, they correct our hearts, our minds, and our souls in order to be in better relationship and conformity with God's will to confront the desert in our own life. And so we ask ourselves, what is in our deserts? Because certainly, too, as we are just several days into Lenten season, I feel like we're kind of in that mode of when we start a new year and we make New Year's resolutions. And then we realize a few days into a new year that what we committed ourselves to has either was like not a good idea, or maybe it has unearthed other questions or issues or things that we really need to focus in on. And so now is the time to ask ourselves what is really there, what is really in our deserts as we have taken on Lenten practices. Is there something that requires a second look? Maybe something that we need to fast from more, and not just simply food, but maybe fasting from a behavior or technology or something that is keeping us estranged from one another. And all these things, again, they help us to grow in conformity to God's will. For as we hear in Psalm 25 today, that is proclaimed to us, it says, "Your ways, O Lord, are love and truth to those who keep your covenant." Interestingly enough, it's love and truth are to those who keep your covenant. Now, this isn't to say that God's love is conditional in any way, because we know it's not. God unconditionally loves us. But also we know that when, as also the psalm would say in verses 8 and 9, that humility helps us, it teaches the humble the way, or humility, in other words, a central part of prayer, helps us to encounter the Lord. This is all to say that, again, God's love is not conditional, but yet when we fall outside of, when we enter into the desert and we fall to sin and fall to temptation, we also, the idea and the knowledge of God's love and truth also are askew in our own life. And so therefore, when those things are not in line with God's will or out of whack in our own world or our own self, that we can exclude ourselves from feeling or experiencing the truth and the fullness of God's covenant. It's not so much that God changes, but we change. And so it is through prayer, fasting, and almsgiving, these things that help lead us to conversion, that help us to confront what is in our personal deserts. And so, my brothers and sisters, as we are invited to follow the Lord, to follow Christ, to walk with him in the desert experience during these 40 days, so we may experience the joy of Easter, so we may experience the new life given to us through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. May we have courage this week to confront, to ask ourselves, what is in our deserts? What is in my desert? And may we allow ourselves to enter into further prayer, fasting, or almsgiving, that those things may be confronted and that we may experience the new life that Christ desires for each of us. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things are made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate to the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Trusting in the Lord, let us now place before him our prayers of intercession.
The response is, Lord, hear our prayer. That all baptized Christians faithfully proclaim the reign of God and turn to him in every temptation, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all political leaders avoid temptations of power and greed and serve with sincere generosity those they represent. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all who face obstacles, be physical or emotional, grow in faith-filled stamina and determination. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all who are on their journey to the Easter sacraments experience the welcome and support of their communities. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the members of this assembly in prayer and fasting be drawn ever more deeply into the Paschal mystery. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may intercede for one another as we mention our many needs and intentions in the silence of our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died in Christ, especially for Celia Simon, whom we remember in a special way at this Mass, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, in your mercy, hear these our prayers. Grant them according to your will. We ask all this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The second collection is quarterly collection.
Our offertory hymn is number 658, Turn to Me.
Says the Lord, for I am God.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we receive the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands, will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we receive the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
Accept the sacrifice of your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all of his holy church.
Give us the right dispositions, O Lord, we pray, to make these offerings, for with them we celebrate the beginning of this venerable and sacred time, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, by abstaining 40 long days from earthly food, he consecrated through his fast a pattern of our Lenten observance. And by overturning the snares of the ancient serpent, taught us to cast out the leaven of malice, so that celebrating worthily the Paschal mystery, we might pass over at last to the eternal Paschal feast. And so with company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we acclaim. So that the human race may become holy, just as you yourself are holy. Look, we pray, upon your people's offerings, and pour out on them the power of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, in whom we too are your sons and daughters. Indeed, though we were once lost and could not approach you, you loved us with the greatest love for your Son, who alone is just, handing himself over to death, and did not disdain to be nailed for our sake to the wood of the cross. But before his arms were outstretched between heaven and earth to become the lasting sign of your covenant, he desired to celebrate the Passover with his disciples. As he ate with them, he took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to them, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, knowing that he was about to reconcile all things in himself through his blood to be shed on the cross, he took the chalice filled with the fruit of the vine, and once more giving it thanks, he handed the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me.
A mystery of faith.
Jesus Christ, who is our Passover and our surest peace. We celebrate his death and resurrection from the dead, and looking forward to his blessed coming, we offer you, who are our faithful and merciful God, the sacrificial victim who reconciles to you the human race. Look kindly, most compassionate Father, on those who unite to yourself by a sacrifice of your Son, and grant that by the power of the Holy Spirit, as they partake of this one bread and one chalice, they may be gathered into one body in Christ, who heals every division. Be pleased to keep us always in communion of mind and heart, together with Francis our Pope and Edward our Bishop. Help us to work together for the coming of your kingdom, until the hour when we stand before you, saints among the saints in the halls of heaven, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints, and with our deceased brothers and sisters, whom we humbly commend to your mercy. Then freed at last from the womb of corruption and made fully into a new creation, we shall sing to you with gladness the thanksgiving of Christ, who lives for all eternity.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Informed by divine teaching, we now dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer to each other a sign of peace.
Takes away the sins of the world.
Blessed are those who are called to a supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Our communion hymn is number 441, On Eagle's Wings.
Let us pray. Renewed now with heavenly bread, by which faith is nourished, hope increased, and charity strengthened, we pray, O Lord, that we may learn to hunger for Christ, the true and living bread, and strive to live by every word which proceeds from your mouth. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Those taking the Eucharist at home, bow, please come forward. Let's take the gift of Christ's heart, share our prayers, longings, and support. horrifying and blessing, just a few announcements. The first of which being during the month of March, we are going to, on the Wednesday, first three Wednesdays, be hosting evening prayer with Eucharistic adoration and also soup and bread dinner to follow. So our first one is coming up on Wednesday, March 6th. Evening prayer, which is similar to night prayer that we prayed last year during the nine nights in March. The evening prayer and Eucharistic adoration is at 6:30 p.m. and then the soup and bread dinner will follow at 7 p.m. If you can help or assist in any way, especially by bringing a soup or bread, that'd be great. There's a sign up at the Seville site. And I forgot what I was going to say about that, but again, that's going to happen. The first one's going to be at Seville on March 6th at 6:30 p.m. And then secondly, on the Bible study on the Book of Psalms, we'll begin March 7th, and those registration forms and also the donation fee is due in the parish office this week or soon, so please register as soon as possible. Stations of the Cross coming up this week will be on Friday the 23rd at 7 p.m. at the Lodi site. And then lastly, there's a lot going on this Lent season, but on Wednesday, February 28th, will be the night of confessions and Eucharistic adoration, and that will be available at the Lodi site from 5 to 8 p.m. So for the adoration, I'll be there for confession. Come anytime between 5 and 8 p.m. for confession and or quiet prayer. The Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
Bow your heads for God's blessing. May bountiful blessing, O Lord, we pray, come down upon your people, that hope may grow in tribulation, virtue be strengthened in temptation, and eternal redemption be assured through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Saint Michael, be our angel, defend us in battle, be our protection against the wickedness and the snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, thrust into hell Satan and all the other evil spirits who prowl about the world seeking the ruin of souls.
Amen. Our closing hymn is number 664, Seek the Lord. The refrain and the verses are A.
As high as the sky is above the earth.